to the European Voices in Translation Festival. We're very pleased to be working together as a group of three organizations. The Goethe Institute, of course, Detlef and Karen have been instrumental, and the Center for the Study of Europe, Elizabeth Emrine, and my name is William Pierce. I'm senior editor of the literary magazine Agni, which is based at Boston University. The moderator of our first panel is James Wood. He's with George Szirtes and László Krasznahorkai. And James hardly needs to be introduced in Boston. He is a staff writer for The New Yorker and arguably, either despite his accent or because of it, America's literary critic in chief. He's the author of, among other books, The Broken Estate, Essays on Literature and Belief, and The Irresponsible Self on Laughter and the Novel, which was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award. At Harvard, he holds the unusual title, Professor of the Practice of Literary Criticism. Before the panel begins, I have just a few bits of quick housekeeping so that everybody knows how things will work. We'll have a break after this, of course, question and answer. But the books are also available over on the table. Elizabeth Emrine of the Center for the Study of Europe has the hammer around the neck there. She's the one you can buy the books from, and then they'll be the authors will be available for signing. Thank you, James.
It's a huge pleasure to introduce these two great writers and to be introducing them in Boston, where I live. I was just telling George Szirtes that I grew up reading his poetry. My very enlightened school teacher who handed me a book called Poetry Introduction 4 from 1978, which had work by Alan Hollinghurst, Craig Raine, and George Szirtes. I have read his work pretty much since that moment. He's best known, certainly in Britain, for his book, The Silent Door, and Real, which won the 2004 T.S. Eliot Prize. And he's going to read from a number of works, but poems, particularly in his book, The Burning of the Books. And after he has read, László Krasznahorkai is going to read for about 20 minutes also. I last encountered László in New York City a couple of years ago when, to a packed room at the Housing Works bookshop, László read from Irenaeus' speech in Satin Tango and held the room utterly spellbound for 20 or 25 minutes as we became that fictional audience. He became that dubious prophet. I don't want to talk anymore because you're not here to listen to me, you're here to listen to these two writers. Once they have both read, we will talk a little bit at the table, and then it'll be a pleasure to get questions from the audience. Mr. Krasznahorkai also wanted you to know that at the very end, he would like to read a very short text to finish the session. So we'll begin with George Szirtes' poems.
It's a great honor to be here in Boston with James and with László, whom I've had the pleasure of translating at least some of the time for a good number of years now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read for about 20, 25 minutes. I'll begin with a couple of poems from The Burning of the Books. The subject of my reading, I'll begin with two of the three poems which are essentially about Central Europe in different sorts of ways. I'll pass through the area broadly, thinking of language, which is what I'm really thinking of. And I'll finish off with two or three points to do with translation itself, which are fairly new. The very first poem I shall read is from the title series of The Burning of the Books, and it is, the project was to write a series of poems ghosting the events of Elias Canetti's auto da fe. This was suggested to me by an artist friend. So essentially what you're going to hear, I'll read you two of these poems from that series. They're quite fast-paced poems. They are annotations in some way, but they're slightly fantastical annotations which can go in any direction. Does anybody here know the book at all? It's a rather sort of magnificent, dark book. It's about a man who's a scholar and a collector of books, a collector of fine books. And I give the various characters and the various situations their voice. This is about books and dust, which anybody who has a lot of books will know about, I think, quite directly. Where books are gathered, there gathers also the dust that sits through the pores of the skin and the head. The absolute dust of the language that falls apart in your hands, that settles in your palm like a promise. Ideas are dust, words dust, a universe of dust between planet and planet. Precious dust, certainly. Gold dust, a dusting of light filtered through eyelashes, batting over the damp smelling page, the foxing, the marginals, the improvised shopping list of the dead themselves, the dust of the prisons, the workhouses of dust, the dust bowl, the dustbin of history, the dust of the poor who have wasted away into particles, molecules, atoms, the dust of the birds in their nests, the dust of the hotel where the dwarf and the scholar fossick among moats, among invisible books, the books of the imagination. The trapped dust of the folded page, the folded umbrella, the folds of the skin that are clogged with dust of the ovens to come, the dust of the scouring pad, the citizens of dust in the dusty streets, the dust of the city you shake off your sandals, the dust mites, the silverfish of the imagination, the dust of the station where a speech is in progress, the dust of the mountain pass with its budget soldiers. Librarian of the Universal Library, have you explored the shelves in the stockroom where the snipers are sitting, the repository of landmines in the parking bay, the suspicious white powder at the checkout desk, the mysterious rays bombarding you by the photocopier, the psychological disorder of the filing system that governs the paranoid republic of print in the wastes of the world? Out of the phase set in the 1930s, and it is absolutely full of the premonitions of the war to come. It's a very brutal book, it's a very dark book. The dwarf is an actual character who appears in the book. The scholar is called Keane. I'll read you one more from this. This is called She Opened the Book and Read. In the book itself, the scholar is looking for somebody to help him at Wikipedia do the housework. And he finds a maid, and this maid, although she's well in her 50s and described as somebody wearing an iron skirt, she hands him the book wearing kid gloves. And because she hands him the book in kid gloves, he thinks, this is the woman for me. I'm going to marry this woman, which he does. It's a disaster. But he's a very wealthy man. And this is Keane reflecting a little bit on the value of books and the idea of money. He is a very rich man. Once she had passed over the kid gloves, and a book appeared with its antiquary bloom, its insect words pinned into place with light, it was clear there was expense involved. Expense and respect and a question of property. I don't deal with property. I am a scholar. I don't do housekeeping, I don't do money. I do the rounds of the bookshops, interrogating dealers with rare editions in long-lost languages. I have circumnavigated the alleys of Berlin more often than I can remember, but I recall perfectly the place of each book on its shelf and have marked its neighbors and condition. Money is air. I breathe it in and out. I blow my nose clear of it. I kiss it in the morning and last thing at night. Money is a slight breeze playing round my temples as I enter the shop, a slight draught at my back as I leave it. It is a whisper of fallen leaves in the gutter, the rustle half dry and half damp of a system in decay. Pass me the kid gloves. I'm handling a book. The words of the dead are settling over me. I drift among them, weightless, like a balloon floating on helium, looking down on gutters overflowing with leaves and paper money. I don't see the difference. This is a straightforward sonnet. I'll tell you about that sort of later. This is called Central Europe. It's a relatively new poem. Whenever I see some of the would-be guardians of the state, I see a very smart bunch of people, rammed straight, fine moustaches, and it was scary, actually. Central Europe. How admirable they are, these sober gentlemen, with their silver hair and patriotic moustaches. Their straight backs, their handsome, faintly malicious smiles, their authority, their quiet gravamen. They are assuredly the very soul of the nation, who look to assure us and strive to look reassuring. Exemplars of uprightness, objects of admiration, who have always been there and are the enduring face of the people for which the nation has fought. You couldn't imagine them with a gun by a ditch surveying a row of corpses. Perish the thought. They wouldn't murder their despicable enemies. They'd simply tidy them up like an unfortunate glitch in a program and straighten their sober grey ties. This is a poem called Bruno Schulz, she said. I'm a great lover and admirer of Bruno Schulz. Bruno Schulz, a great writer of Fantasy Street of Crocodiles, etc., which I think are of enormous influence, actually, on many imaginations and spring out of many imaginations. But it's a poem called Bruno Schulz, she said. I no longer know the difference between nightmare and dreaming, she said. Almost everything I see in dreams frightens me, she said. It was dark. Most wonderful things. Doors that open on heaven remain dark, she said. I would like to wake at a moment of brightness, unafraid, she said. It's all parody, echo of echo, she said. I can't hear things straight. I've met Bruno Schulz. He sleeps in my bed, she said, though I can't see him. Schulz is just a name I can't get out of my head, like music, she said. And so she talked on, changing genders now and then, telling me her dreams. But I couldn't say what the difference was myself. I too was dreaming. We were together in this. She kept on talking. It was a long night. This is from, I'm fascinated by poems of all kinds. These are mostly in the form of syllabic veterinary haiku joined together. That was, so it says. This is called Like Petrol Engines. I'm slowly moving into the theme of language. I want to move over from Central Europe into this question of language. Like placing a stone in the dead center of night, a hard, lifeless sun. Like falling from day into an electric pool of unlit currents. Like horizontal. Like fish alive on a slab. Like breathing. Like life. Like a parallel existence. Like another. Like something out here. Like the rain in dreams, only absent. Like the rain in life, still falling. Like a distant car moving towards you, like that raw engine. Like time in darkness, undetectable, hanging, uncertain yet clear. To sing what is like, to talk into parallels, to think by quarter, speak into silence, Who listens as intently? Who answers? Who waits? And the night opens its hands and gives you something, the gift of plain kindness. Another one along those lines is Among Animals. There's a lot of, on the flight over, I was watching Her in the movie, where you've got an artificial intelligence voice and falls in love with that. I mean, that's very interesting. That's a very old sort of debate about what's computer-like about us, selves and so forth. But I've become really quite interested in what way we are like animals, or how far we've become like animals. So this is called Among Animals. Touch the animals in your head. They bend to you gently as to food. They shuffle along from arc to arc, obedient as your own shadow. You feed the creatures with the pity they inspire, your imagined tribe. The domestic cat that winds its body around you and lives in your throat. The tame dog you feed that is your several limbs and your lifted hat. And all the wild beasts in your eyes, what will you do with them while you sleep? Here's a stuffed giraffe of childhood, and its long neck. Here is its faint smile. Here is the caged bird you spent such hours talking to. Will it now talk back? The inhabitants of your body have gathered in herds to hear you. What will you say now your languages have failed you and your eyes are lost? Creatures construct you. The world put you together as its quaint puzzle. Now you dismantle the night. Now you call the dark to its vast kennel. Your territory is crowded with animals that go their own ways. Behold your creatures, says the book of the body. Converse with your tribe. I read a poem from the new book, which is in a different edition over there. This is still to deal with the fascination of language, but it's a love poem at the same time. It's in the form of a canzone. A canzone is a so strange, archaic form. It's 65 lines, and you only got five N-words, and you keep going round and round. It's like voluntarily entering a spin dryer or a whirlpool. But the same old words keep coming back at you. It's a fantasy after Theodore Rethke, the one I knew a woman lovely in her bones, and then she has a line, and when she moved more ways than one. And that's the theme upon which everything else plays. And it kind of goes whizzing around, and every so often I think it kind of falls into something which comes in this absolutely perfect sense, like a magnificent insight. And yet I'm not sure what it is at all, then it's just the like things going round and round. Sorry, you've heard it fast. It's 65 lines, the longest thing I do. Ah, when she moved more ways than one. But that's just movement as a cat performs, beauty enough for cats. For anyone, because a movement can be more than one, and several is how they spent the day. And she was several, far more than one, just more perhaps of one than anyone in terms of movement, nothing standing still for long enough, though they themselves stood still, while moving on, refusing just the one mode of movement or fixity of place, and so they kept on moving place to place. And this is where they were. This was the place where she was moving. Every movement one with the next, each fitting into place, then shifting on, discarding sense of place. And he stood by, seeing how grace performs itself, and knows its place beyond the place provided for it, never the perfect place. You love the many, and you love the one, but many may be focused into one. You want the thing, you want it in a place. You want it how you want it, to be still as poised, he thought, and constant as if still in movement, loving all that remains still in her, the sense of being in a place, not of it. And the sense he made was still a point of stillness in her being still. So when she moved, it was more ways than one, he noted, as she moved by being still. One might move so, and yet remain quite still, he said. It's life that holds her and performs the daily ritual she herself performs. And she performs herself beyond the one still moment of performance in the day that moves past her and will not spare the day. But this was where she moved, it being day she moved through, and so perfectly at one with day, and it with her, day after day, with nights to come, the body of the day turning to sleep, an image in a place they lay and moved in a dream of day working its way through the body, and a day as though her body, his dream and day were one. Most times, timeless. Time knows only one mode of being, rushing through the day, ticking of items, the functions it performs, performable, but not what she performs. They were, he thought, what permanence performs, when permanence is saved for just one day. So day performs, so anything performs itself by moving, being what performs, because performance is like standing still while moving, and so everything performs, movement, stillness. Whatever thing performs, what happens. And it happens in this place or that, the whole being only the place she moves in, and by moving in, performs. So she, he thought, must clearly be the one who holds the movement still, as if at one with both the stillness and the movement, one moment here or there, then the whole place. The body moved, and then she stopped quite still. Still as the world compacted into day, there's several parts, and all that day performs. And these are all about translation in one way or the other. An activity which is fascinating, but about which I had a constant sense of unease. I was thinking of translation, I was giving a lecture about translation, so I was thinking of that passage in Hamlet where he talks to Polonius and he looks at this cloud and he says, oh, it's very like a whale, it's an elephant, it's not a camel, that's a wolf, the rock, etc. You look at this cloud and you try to read things into it. And this isn't only from another language, it's from your own language, in your own sense of saying. So I read you that, and then I read your poem called The Death of the Translator. Sometimes you see clouds drifting past the city, inventions of the sky, within which images appeared and petrified, and remained there in perpetuity. Otherwise things shift with a certain insouciance, but keep moving. Meaning vanishes into night, into the vacant parishes of the imagination, into a non-presence that is positively terrifying. But there, the clouds still loom like statues with faces, as if one could choose to see them suspended in imagined air. I have jumped to conclusions in my time. What else would you jump to, otherwise? Look hard into the eyes of language, and you see nothing, only rhyme and punctuation. I have talked to ghosts in ghost language, the solemn dead at their jabber, hearing the implied instead, the sigh of the wind at its last post. I once had a mother who used at times to speak, but now I only conjure her. We carve images into clouds so we should not starve for lack of company. We break the silence into pieces, syllables of space. We are translated into ourselves. The sky rushes at us. We observe it insouciantly, watching clouds move, looking for a face. We have seen mirrors in darkened rooms hunger for us. We have seen the dead in our streets. We have felt the dread of our faces and the shapes of face assumes in its own mirror. We owe them a shape, all those faceless ones, you and I. We should feed them before they petrify, before their clouds pack up or else escape. How do I know myself before I have created my simulacrum? How are the hungry to be fed? Listen, the sky is angry. The gods are demanding to be translated. Now, I read just part of The Death of the Translator, which is really a series of midnight brief reflections upon the act. So The Death of the Translator, like The Death of the Author, you know, the two go together. The translator meets himself emerging from his lover's bedroom. So much for fidelity, he thinks. Je est un autre, said the translator. Try next door. The translator was looking down his own throat. Come out, wherever you are, he pleaded. The translator's wardrobe was full of other people's shirts. At least they fitted him. The translator stood in front of the window pretending to be transparent. But if everything is potentially everything else, complained the translator, what am I doing here? The translator was counting his chickens, none of them hatched but already squabbling. The translator wanders into Babel and books himself into a cupboard. Two languages on the same floor of Babel. I was here first, I'm talking to you. Keep the music down, you call that music. The blind translator had developed his sense of smell to an exquisite pitch. He could read a book the way a dog reads lampposts. The blind translator felt his way through the book, knocking whole sentences over. He'd have to build it all again by touch. A poet and a translator walk into a bar. Give me a beer, says the poet. I suppose you'd better give him a beer, says the translator. The translator was admiring his dead poets. Not that I'm alive myself, he remarked, but at least I keep moving. The translator was tracking the bear, but kept wondering why the bear was wearing his shoes. Bears are thieves, he muttered. Two translators meet each other, examine their teeth. Whose teeth are those, he asked? He lined up the translators and shot them. Which one was a poet, asked the soldier. Fourth one along, maybe fifth, not that it matters. The translator lay dead, but they buried someone else. Then they brought in someone else. We are legion, says the devil. We are the foreign legion, answers the translator. And I'll finish with this poem called Polyphonic. I like having several voices. People say, used to say in kind of growing up, I can must find your voice and say, well, where is it? Where have I left it? Have I forgotten it again? Perhaps it's over there. While he was talking, another voice crept under his tongue and stayed there. The voice was not strange. It felt quite comfortable, tucked into his mouth. It curled there and spoke as a shadow might, when there is room for shadows. Nothing that is mine can be strange, he told himself. This, too, is my voice. Reassuring words. But the voice in his mouth sang to a different score. It's polyphony, he argued, but the guest voice carried on singing. This is what the guest voice says. There are things we say that say themselves in the way they have to be said. Regard the flowers nodding in the garden, lost in their own music. He would have listened out of courtesy and held his unruly tongue. But his mouth was full of compelling flowers of speech, so he kept talking. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. There are two essays, and the distance between these two is approximately 30 years. The first one from the middle of the 70s. A good 100 years ago, in 1889, on a day very like today in Turin, Friedrich Nietzsche sets out from the gate of number 6 via Carlo Alberto, possibly to take a walk, perhaps in order to go to the post office to pick up his mail. Not far off, so it may be very far from him by that time, he spots the driver of a carriage, let us suppose, struggling with an obstinate horse. However, the driver chides the horse. The horse refuses to move, and so the driver, Giuseppe Carlo Ettore, loses his temper and starts beating the animal with his whip. Nietzsche arrives at this, let us call it, fracas. So by this time, the singular drama of the driver, who is no doubt sweating and exhausted by his fury, is over. But the enormous figure with the resplendent mustache suddenly leaps over to the driver and to the barely hidden amusement of the crowd, embraces the horse's neck and starts sobbing. His landlord takes him home, where he lies on a divan for 2 days without speaking or moving, before pronouncing the obligatory last words, Mutter, ich bin dumm. Then, in the care of her sister and his gentle, grief-crazed mother, he lives on for another 10 years. No one knows what happened to the horse. That is, one should say, a highly unreliable account, though the natural tendency at such times to believe strong narratives, it lends it a certain credence and casts a particularly intense light on the last acts of the spirit according to a dramatized model of the intellect. The demonic star of living philosophy, the brilliant opponent of so-called universal human truths, the inimitable hero who almost chokes on the word no when he denies sympathy, forgiving and goodness, is he really hanging on to the neck of a flagged horse to deploy an unforgivably common but necessary objection? How come he's not hanging on to the neck of the driver? With great respect to Dr. Möbius, to whom all this represented nothing more than a simple case of progressive paralysis common to the syphilitics, we later generations feel we are witnessing, as if by flashlight, a tragic mistake. What we see is the very soul of Nietzsche, after a long and exhausting struggle, saying no to a line of Nietzsche's own thought that was bound to lead to a particular form of hell. Thomas Mann suggests his mistake was that the gentle prophet of a life of passions regarded life and morality as opposing values. The truth, he adds, is that they are inseparable. Ethics supports life, and moral man is the true citizen of life. The statement of man's is so beautiful, such an unconditionally noble sentiment, that it might be worth taking some time out and sailing on with it, but we won't do that now, since our ship is being steered by Nietzsche, as he was in Turin, and this means not only sailing other waters, but requires an entirely different nervous system. Indeed, a condition that, in an appropriate turn of phrase, we might regard as approaching nevertheless. And we will need it because, to our extreme consternation, it entails us sailing into exactly the same harbor as Mann's sentence does. We will need it because, while the harbor is the same, what we feel on our arrival will be very different from what he promises us we will feel. The drama of Nietzsche in Turin suggests that living in the spirit of the moral law cannot be regarded as a virtue because we have no choice. I may live counter to the spirit, but that does not release me from the mysterious and truly unnameable power that binds me firmly to it. If I do so and live counter to it, I will certainly adjust to the regrettable social existence that locates me in the human scheme of things, with all those concomitant limits on crude intervention, within which nothing can possibly surprise anyone, and where, in Nietzsche's own words, to live is to be unjust, but I don't know where I stand in the unresolvable conflict that from time to time lands me right at the heart of the desperate yearning for the meaning of my existence. Because in so far as I am part of the social world, I am also part of something I always name as, who knows why, the greater whole, a greater whole that has to take a passing glance at the Kantian categorical imperative, implanted a law in me, this particular law that it is the set prerogative of freedom to negate freedom. We are now steering past the buoys of the dock, a little blindly, because the sleeping staff of the lighthouse cannot help us with our maneuvers, ready as we are, once safely within the walls of the harbor, to cast anchor in the dim light, at which point any question about whether the greater whole is likely to reflect the higher meanings of the enigma is immediately lost in the darkness. And so that is where we are, knowing nothing, only watching as our fellow humans slowly approach us from a thousand different angles, not trying to communicate, our communion completely filling us, silencing us. And we think we are right to have this sense of communion, that those approaching us are also right in having it, because even if they don't have it now, they'll have it tomorrow, or in 10, or in 30 years' time, at the latest in Turin. The second text is from the beginning of 2000. The nature of a writer's power. It lies within a writer's power to envisage and accept that if it is still at all possible to respond to the question relating to the writer's power, by the same token, it is still impossible to give an answer to the real expectation inherent in the question, so maybe as yet concealed to the questioner for the answer, which does not get to the heart of the questioner's question, and that the questioner does not understand, is no answer. Yet right in the middle of a troubled period of historical hopes and visions, he, the questioner, would no doubt be unable to understand that an end has been reached, an end to the happy world of mutual elusiveness, an end to our linked culture's poetic binding material, that irretrievable blend of love and a kind of sensitivity to beauty and a desire for universal discovery. And he would no doubt not understand that this binding material was already gradually starting to lose its strength from the beginning of the 20th century, as conceived in the conventional manner of the preceding century, and in a merciless wind which was blowing from the 21st century, was starting to molder from between the bricks of the glorious walls that gird our cities, so that this next century, the 21st, as dreamed in the 20s, would be governed by a truly brand new and for us frightening fact, the idea of all-consuming, gross-fixated profit, of which all we notice now is that the reality of place and individuality are disappearing, and that both place and individuality are losing their original meaning insofar as we are no longer able to assert, as we were right up until the 19th century, that there is something here or there, or else, as in the 19th century, there was something, given that according to the present state of knowledge, things were there yet not there, are here yet not here. And meanwhile, the reality that had become or was becoming the past is our soul, albeit incomprehensible experience. How then could we explain to the questioner that the idea of an individuality that is now falling into extinction is roughly a signal that after the final revolution in society, the part of mankind that still has the capability at all is now about to change afresh. And again, what we see is that children turn to their parents in a slightly different way, and parents likewise to their children, the youngsters slightly differently to the older person, and the older person to the youngster, a woman differently to a man, just as a man to a woman. So how should we explain to him that we are without a home, a state, or a sight of the world, and that in the present spiritual moment, sadly, no amount of hysterical clinging to the home, the state, and the world can do anything about this? And how are we going to make the questioner understand that there is no place at all here for sadness about this? Instead, we must far rather nod our assent to this and that, to everything that is going to happen, with an impassive post-Keaton expression, and suffer the undeniable bitterness accordingly, like adults, in just the way that, to avail myself briefly and by way of a farewell of the intimate tone of a personal confession, returning home one day from I know not where, by train as it happened, between 5:30 and 5:45 on a deliberately hot and scorching summer evening, I noticed for the first time that I felt no pleasure at all over arriving back home. And since then, I have been incapable of feeling pleasure over arriving back home. Not that I have no desire to feel pleasure over arriving back home, but, and this is what always makes me so despondent, because it is precisely on the homeward-bound journey that I am incapable of feeling pleasure over arriving back home. Although in the other direction, which is to say when my movement is in the moving away from home direction, I don't feel any pleasure of relief or curiosity, but an absolute certainty of hopelessness. Because right then I am moving away from the very thing that I suppose I ought to be continually approaching. Just as I suppose it would also be very hard to explain that, according to the sense of the above story, in truth, we have nothing to do with the culture of the center in which we happen to be living. And meanwhile, it is precisely this that is in truth impossible to comprehend with our old brains, that there is nowhere and no reason, impossible to accept to our age, has not sought the fact and cause of true beauties and all beautiful illusions in nature beyond mankind, but has far rather explored the fact and cause of horrors, and no doubt with good reason, since in truth it lighted upon these exclusively. So it could have searched here at least, in this larger entity, the questioner would object. But it didn't do so, because it was blinded by the horror of human nature. And after all this, we would fall silent. We would not in the end utter so much as a single word, only finding words after a decent interval to articulate the thought that it's impossible that it should be over, that it should cease, that there is homelessness and statelessness everywhere, and only words are left, words forever, about dignity, about the madness in the idea of dignity, about the simpleton who is no longer noticed by anyone, who just keeps muttering the same thing over and over again, in some shady nook of one of the northern suburbs of Sao Paulo, in a southern slum of Lagos in Nigeria, or as it happens in the city center of Oradea, on one of its dreadful, notorious old buses routes, there in the back seat, muttering and yowling and whining like an animal, saying, home, home, let's go home.
Two wonderful readings, and one way we might start the discussion is to talk about translation, since you wrote some marvelous poems on the subject, and because László's last essay, I don't know who translated that into English.
I hope George wrote my translator.
László sent it to me because the last few sentences had not been translated. He said, did you translate this?
And I wasn't sure. I couldn't find it on the computers. But it was okay. It was okay. It wasn't something to be ashamed of.
Well,
I
felt László was getting into his rhythm. The long sentences were extraordinary in that last essay, and I thought how difficult that would be to render into English. I wanted to ask you, George, something you said, this is specifically about translating László's work, but feel free to expand generally, because it's an interesting subject. You said that there's an irony implicit in the Hungarian text that you've translated of László's, but they grow a little in translation. And
yeah.
I was interested in that idea. Yeah.
Well, I myself find it a kind of fascinating idea, but that was my experience of it. There's a slightly different kind of darkness in English than in Hungarian, as far as I can tell. Or at least what happens as it passes through my hands, it gathers that, because there are certain different kinds of values and valences in those very long sentences. They mean something slightly different in English. They're relatively rare in English, so to speak. You know, you get them sort of in Henry James and you get them sort of in other places, mm-hmm. but not in that sort of great, continuous kind of unfolding. And what happens when you move that through is that your ear, as you're translating, you're trying to hear the reader as well. Mm. And you're having this kind of relationship with the reader, and you're aware that the reader might say, well, let me give you a perfect example of this, okay. Mm-hmm. The Melancholy of Resistance, as Ellen Anash, Melancholia, the first book I translated. This is always the scene I come back to, where the very reclusive ex-head of the music academy is informed by the local simpleton, who's actually much more than a simpleton, mm-hmm. that there's a riot brewing and that he had better start boarding up his windows. So he starts boarding up his windows. The only trouble is that this man has never held a hammer and has never actually hit a nail with a hammer. So there's this quite long disquisition, which is very eloquent, in which he is wondering, should I concentrate on a nail head or the hammer head? Should I hold a hammer in the middle or at the bottom? Should I trace the movement of the hammer all the way through, etc.? So as you unwrap this thing, it retains its darkness, but it is essentially comical in its own kind of sinister sort of way. Thank you.
Can I talk a little bit? A very small story about this scene. After the communist system was over, a friend of mine, a film director, George Feher, made a record with me, and he asked me to read this, only this part of this book. How can people use a hammer and nail. Only this part. And it took approximately half an hour. And it was almost crazy in the 1990, in a Sunday evening after the main movie, immediately, for I don't know 6 million people, only my faces could try to explain for the people how can use right in the right way hammer and nail. 30 minutes long. That was absolutely a big scandal, and people in Hungary could understand, no, this is really the change.
Well, let me ask you about the are you aware, László, of your work having what George called these different valences in other languages that you know, say in German? How do you feel, to go back to the long sentence, I mean, does the long sentence have a different kind of atmosphere and status in, say, Hungarian as it has in English or in German, just to take those things?
I think so, yes. There is a big difference, but my opinion, anyway, this is a little bit strange about the translation, because, for example, if we have a book by me in English, let me say, Sable There Below, or by George, Saturn Tango, or Melancholy Resistance, I could show for you, and my original too, and I could say only that it was written by me, it was written by George Szirtes. Because really, in fact, every word of the English Melancholy of Resistance was written by George. Every word, you know? And the whole problematic with the long sentence. Of course, I was very, very close to the opinion that George uses so beautiful English language that I could imagine that he, like a poet, not a translator, can translate my unusual, also in the Hungarian language, a little bit unusual sentences or system of sentences. I think of a little bit different about sentence, because these so-called short sentences with a beginning and quite short period at the end. This cutting, you know, this is a little bit, for me, artificial. Actually, this is artificial, and my long sentences, in my opinion, of course, the natural speech, you know, and that was from the beginning my case, that when I started to write sentences, that was always a little bit artificial to cut, to make cutting, you know. And that was a fertilization, of course, of Dinatar as well, because before my meeting with Bill, Bill was a normal film director with a very 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 good talented man. But after that, yes. After that, everything was a big problem. Of course.
Actually, some of my sentences are longer than László's, because in order to accommodate them into English, sometimes you have a Hungarian agglutinates for a start. So in order to get all these various parts of speech in, and to make these long sentences slightly lordly and slightly kind of let them, if you like, settle into a language a little bit more, you do actually sometimes have to give slightly more space. I think the longest sentence that I remember is in War and War, where every chapter was probably a sentence.
Yeah, every chapter was long.
So there were 8-page long sentences and so on.
How, in contemporary
Hungarian writing, how common is, not your sentence obviously, but longish sentences? Would you say that that is generally more of an established element in Hungarian writing than, say, in English?
I think actually László may be a better person to ask this mm-hmm. than me. I know I once had the lack of pleasure of translating an art historical text, a Hungarian art historical text, which was very clearly patterned on a German model, or so it seemed to me, and it seemed extraordinarily tedious. But I thought it was kind of within the realms of Hungarian to have adopted it, but to adopt it with grace and to adopt it with a kind of cumulative power, which László uses it, it seems to me rare. But as I said, László would know more about that.
I think so that in the case of modern Hungarian language, we had a past with the Hungarian language, namely from if we could go back to the 16th, 18th century, the Latin, the language. Latin was the common language in Hungary, actually from 1000 until, I don't know, until 19th century or a little bit more. But and the Latin language influenced absolute strong to the Hungarian, and that's why the first movement. Of the for the Hungarian language, used the poets and writers in the late 18th century, early 19th century, very short sentences, because they believed we have to find our own language system and sentence system and style and so on, because the Latin was so unbelievably strong, you know. And now, when I started my books, that was very easy to go back to this tradition, because that was very easy to discover that the Hungarian language is able to build a very big serious sentence. It's not only this very short. That was always a cast. That was always a banal sentence in the Hungarian literature until the modern time, that the true Hungarian uses only short sentences and no speak when he eats or when he takes a dinner or something like that. Such an idiot things. But that was really true. And that was not a complicated process for me. Yes. Although I am quite alone with this very, very huge sentence, because this is not a kind of sentence. This is a kind of sentence, of course, but I think of the sentence absolutely different than every other Hungarian writer. I don't need a period. Absolutely not. What more? I have some problem with period, of course, because I think that I believe sometimes that to take the point it belongs not to me.
Well, of course, that's one of the. I mean, reading you, one is so powerfully aware of a voice that is, of course. A mental voice that may not always say in war and war be in control of its rationality or its own procedures. And of course, there's no reason why our mental voices don't end. So why involve oneself in the artificial periodization of the full stop? I think that's one of the great. Beauties of reading you. Just to go back to translation for a minute. I wanted to ask George whether you've translated your own verse back from English into Hungarian a fair amount, and that must be
another kind of experience.
No, I've never done that.
You've never done that?
No. I've never written in Hungarian. I've been translated by other people mm-hmm. into Hungarian, and I can't even tell how well, because there's a kind of blindness or deafness involved in hearing yourself coming back. Mm. So I don't really know that. I mean, there's just one thought on this long sentence, I think. Not that it's the entire feature, but I think once you're inside one of these things, you don't get out. Okay, you're living within that sentence for quite a long time. Mm. That is part of its hypnotic power. Yeah. And of course, you can't always tell, as I think you were hinting, whether the voice that is speaking is, well, to put it crudely, mad, or at least, you know, in some ways far removed from the normal. Yes. So you are constantly alone with this voice which has kind of surrounded you. I think when I was first translating Melancholy Resistance, I compared it to a slow flow of lava.
Yes.
That the whole thing comes down at you and, you know, it envelops you. And that's what's so hypnotic about it.
Yeah. I love that deliberate confusion. I think my favorite moment, one of them, in War and War might be this particular sentence. Believe me when I say, as I said before, he said, that the whole thing is unreadable, insane! Exclamation mark.
It's a bit like Max Sebald, actually.
Yes.
Sebald does that sort of thing where he elides from he said, she said. Yeah. And for after a little while, you forget who's doing the speaking.
Yeah.
That there's a single kind of voice which simply modulates into that person and then into another, and which is, I think, another very important. That's one of the points of affinity, I think.
Yeah, and I noticed in your Bruno Schultz, she said that crucial, that the little addition is it's not just the saving confusion, it's also the thing that pushes the register away from the author into precisely the interlocutor, who may keep on talking and may keep on talking, and isn't who necessarily to be aligned with you.
No, it is a postulated voice.
Yeah.
And this voice has its own identity, except it's not absolutely clear. Yeah. Right at the end of the poem, yeah. She says she's been switching genders, and she might very well be me in some respects, or so she says.
Right. It was a long night. Yeah.
It was a long night.
Wanted to talk about a little bit about the Lazo Fame, the last essay, which is a dense one, and spoke powerfully to me in different registers, particularly the questions of home and belonging, and the way in which you talked about that both at the basic level of not being able to, not necessarily wanting to go home, finding home disappointment after emigration or exile, but also in the way in which, perhaps similar to, I don't know, Hölderlin's poetry, home is also a question of where the gods are, where meaning is, and that can't be recovered either. So I just wondered if you might talk a little bit about if you could, perhaps the best way of forcing you to the point a little vulgarly would just be to say, what do you mean when you say an end has been reached in the essay?
It's a very difficult something to say after this essay, because I try to find for this event some text which is short, and this is not a custom by me that I write something which is not a literary text, especially not in the last 20 years. Mm-hmm. And that's why this text, too, of course, the first one too, and this one too, it's very strange for me.
Mm.
And I am not the same person now. Person who wrote this text, you know, I can, the distance actually between this text, the second part, and me almost the same like your stance, respect, you know.
Right.
And I can't say anything, but this is not about me. I can't say anything about this text between the lost meaning of to be somewhere and the lost meaning of identity. But I can say only something about the person who wrote this text,
so
not about my recent position.
Fair
because my recent position is quite different than the person had. But what can I do? What can I say? The essay is not my genre. This is first. That was my experience.
I didn't hear it as an essay so much as it sounded. It was like a few pages of your fiction torn off.
Even
within it, I felt sometimes you were characteristically dramatizing yourself a little bit, so that it wasn't you speaking always.
I try to find always a way out.
It's like Krasznahorkai, he said.
This is in the mean the message of this second essay or something like that it's come from a person with whom I could begin or start something in a prose. You know, I can imagine this person. I could move with this pattern, the person together, but I cannot make an identification with him. You know, because I tried always a position that I am a distance of my spoken characters.
Let me just ask you then both at just a pretty simple level about home and going home. You both, I know, László, you go back to Hungary a fair amount, but you also live outside the country a lot. George came to England as an immigrant in the 50s and didn't go back to Hungary for a long time, I think, until you were... And presumably now you do go back a fair amount, but I would just be interested to hear from you about your relations to home.
My Bible is in for this question is actually an essay by you.
No, that's not true.
But my book, my Bible is really because what you wrote about this problematic. This is not only philosophical problem, but really a practical problem, where I am, actually, because if you haven't a feeling that you are home, you talk not only about you, but also about the place, and this is very important. And I learned of your essay that this is a very, very difficult case because you deal always only with you. I lost my home. I haven't found my place. Okay, but what happened with the places? What happened with homes?
Right. It's true. There's a kind
they lost as like objects. Their meaning. You know?
Right.
There aren't homes.
Right.
That's the problem. The other side of the problem.
Right.
Not only, I lost my home. Okay, that's
right.
unlucky person. Okay.
Right.
But you and they have this feeling that I'm okay. I'm home. So,
yeah.
It's not the case. The homes, and the places, have changed.
Yes.
Yeah. I think so.
Yeah.
Well, we're very different in this respect, and I went to England with my family at the age of 8. We stopped speaking Hungarian almost immediately and just spoke English. I'd written 3 books in English poetry before going back in 1984. Going back was an extraordinary experience. It was, I think, quite hallucinatory. It was like a city assembling itself in terms of a lived life before me. I was in this hallucination. I was kind of in love with it, and I didn't know, quite know what to do with it. And it opened up a whole new passage in my own writing. And that was the first time, 3 weeks alone. Then I spent three months, and then 9 months in 1989, just as the whole place was beginning to fall apart politically. And what I had fallen in love with, in fact, was Budapest, the city, which I think is a magnificent city in many respects, rather different now from what it was then. After 1989 and during 1989, the idea of it being home receded a little bit, simply because whatever was going to happen to people there wasn't going to happen to me, because I was going to come and go. I had no real stake in, I had nothing to lose. Since then, we've been going back. I'm going back again in about 8-9 days for just about 10 days or so. I think one comes to certain realizations in life regarding the nature and notion of home. There are physically places which are at home. I think in a way when László is talking about the lack of home, in some ways there's a home in the language. Mm. Yeah. In some ways, it would be for others to judge as a home for me in the English language. And we vacillate between these two things. I think that sense of, okay, well, I can't live in Budapest. It's so much has happened. Some of which I haven't liked, actually. So I'm not tempted now to go and stay there for a long time, apart from reasons of research, possibly. But the stronger your bond with the other places, it kind of reflects upon your bond with the other places. I don't know how far László, for example, now feels Berlin is some kind of home is too strong a word. How far it is a habitation. Mm.
Immediately, if I think of my fate, that what's happened with me in this sense, I lost actually everything, also my home, because my home is not Hungary, but a small town in Hungary, but smaller, not this town, but a very small part of this town, a house actually, not the whole house, but only my small room, you know, and that was my home. That was what I have lost, and I have to go back in time if I have to find anything that I really lost. Because every other thing I haven't parents, I haven't relatives there, I haven't. The house is like a bordel recently, a touristic office, office, like a bordel. Yeah. This is the same for me. And this is very, very strange if I very rarely go back to this small town and I show a friend of mine, for example, after the war and war, sculpture from Italy, Mario Metz. Mario was a friend of mine, and we were together to this small town. And I tried, and he was very interested in where was your parents' house. So, and I tried to show, but that was absolutely not the same. That was like a border, really. And I only the location. I could show that was the place in a few quadrat meter. That was my home, you know? And in this sense, for me, the whole world is actually a big dessert. because that was a permanent process in my life that I lost all of it. Because emotional, I depended on very, very, very strong to a place.
Yeah.
You? And this is a permanent.
I just thought I had to add this, is that in the course of translating László, you discover how extremely precise he is about location.
Mm.
So, for example, in translating War and War, the central character takes a walk down the street. I was following the walk on Google. You can do it.
Yeah.
When we were talking a little bit about Satan Tango, so where exactly is this farm? Where exactly is that estate? He knows exactly where it is. So in a way, there he has his very, very precise locations, which is very different for me. I mean, I often thought that in a way, one's natural home is in the imagination anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And that having a home in the imagination part is like sort of having a home on a train or on some mode of transport. That the idea of home, there are writers who have, the English poet Norman Nicholson, for example, who's a very fine poet, he died about 15 years ago, lived all his life in a small town, of Yorkshire town of Millham, in the same house. There are people who do this, who therefore develop extraordinary bonds with such places. Mm. And then there are the other sorts. And in fact, quite a lot of Central European writers, I think, with people with backgrounds, have been travelers. You know, I was reading West Stephen's life and just about how much he has moved around, for example.
Yeah, yeah. No, I can speak to the precision of place in War and War. I remember reading it and being shocked by the appearance of the Latin place name called Stoppeton, which is the Roman name for a town quite near where I was born called Corbridge in Northumberland, where when you get to the Hadrian's Wall bit in War and War, but just completely crossed off. I haven't seen that name since I was a child. I used to go to the Hadrian's Wall Museum and look at the old stones. So I think we should, I'm sure there'll be lots of questions from the audience, and since it's getting on for 2:30, I think we should have 10 minutes or so of, or more of questions from the audience. Anyone wanted to ask either George or László, or both?
I'm interested in the process of giving up your book for translation, because it feels like you say it's not really you who wrote the book, it's Mr. Szirtes who wrote it. So it fascinates me, how do you do that? And I don't know if this is a true, but it's a rumor about Kundera, who wrote the last 15 years or 20 years everything in French, and he refuses to give the right to translate into Czech his own books because he thinks he's the only one who can translate it. In the meantime, he's getting very old. Anyway, it's a long-winded question. How are you dealing with the fact? How are you not possessing your own creation and giving it up? And probably it's similar to like when a book is made into a movie and it becomes something.
First, I love very much the English language which George uses. This is the first one. And after that, I have a big trust in him, of course. And after the first translation by George, which was really fantastic, I could read so that my original language came back from behind. And after the first translation, Melancholy, I had much more trust in him. And I am such a type, you know, that I cannot imagine another person. And that was really a big shock when a few years before, George said, I am too tired for translation. And I want to do my own thing, and I could accept it, and I could understand it. And I was very there were some very unhappy nights for me, what can I do without George? And then, without George is no life for me. And I try to write some very careful letter for George. Okay, in the next, could you imagine a translation in the next 10 years? No, the answer, no. No. Actually, I want to translate only maximum, very, very short pieces. Okay, in this case, I write only short pieces. Not, of course, that was not true, but that was a really desperate situation. And after that, George suggested me a new person. And that was a difficult process, emotional process for me. And he told me always, Ottilie Mulzat. Ottilie Mulzat is a wonderful translator, really translated for difficult texts. And he had a big trust in her. And after that, I was very unsure. You know? And I went always back and back to Georgia after some pages by Ottilie, new translation, that please write me again. Is it okay? Because I cannot judge the English language because I don't speak English. You hear me. And George answered always, be calm. Ottilie is very, very good. But I was always more and more nervous, you know, because I started to believe that this is only sentences by George and he defends his own world. But later it became clear that Ottilie Mulzat is really a wonderful translator. And her first translation, the Sayable Dead Below, mm-hmm. was like a new English language. It's really fantastic. And, this is also George's opinion, because I can judge only behind him.
There was a line in The Death of the Translator which occurs to me almost irresistibly at this point. The translator lay dead, but they buried someone else. Then they brought in someone else. none of us are, you know, I think there's a sense in which, I think what you learn by translating is a quality of a voice. I mean, you can get all kinds of things wrong. Should this thing be a metro? Should it be a tube? Should it be an underground? Well, that's secondary. What you're really listening out for is what this voice is doing and how it's doing it. And then you find a way of creating a voice somewhat like it in your receiving language. It isn't the only solution. It really isn't. There isn't, just as there isn't a single reading of a text in your own language, you will all overlap a little bit. But we will differ. But I think Ottilie Mulzat is splendid, and I'm absolutely delighted for her, and also for László. Mm. Other questions? Yeah.
I was wondering with Satin Tango, if when you saw that, both of you, when you saw it created into film, whether that was at all similar to the process of translating into another language.
Well, I'll answer quickly, then I'll hand over to László. Satan Tango, the film, existed long before I started translating a novel. In fact, I spoke to László in the course of translation, and he said, and I hadn't actually seen the film, and he said, don't look at it, because it's, the film isn't literally, it never is, it isn't literally the book. It is a wonderful film, absolutely marvelous sort of film. But in a way, I didn't actually see the film until I'd more or less done the book.
Only very briefly, the movie Satan Tango is not an adaptation of the novel Satan Tango. There is no traffic between these two. I didn't want to make an adaptation with Béla Tarr. And Béla wanted also absolutely not to make an adaptation. Why? The novel is ready, this literary world is ready. That was an inspiration source of inspiration for Béla Tarr, and I try to understand Béla Tarr, what kind of movie can he imagine him? And if I understood that, I could help him, and I did it. That was all.
What was the name of the film of the melancholy resistance? The variations.
Berkheimer.
Oh, the Werkmeister. Of course. That's very interesting because that is part of the book. It is not the whole of the book. You will recognize. Yeah, it's a proportion, and you will recognize scenes as they describe. But of course, you don't get the voice, and you don't get the precise level of consciousness that the different parts of the book will give you. Magnificent film, absolutely superb, I think. A very good example, of, because in a way I think that is what you're asking, whether the making of a film is a kind of translation. And I think it probably is, but with much greater liberties, I think. You know, I have to go sentence by sentence.
Right.
I have to try and do that, you know, fairly precisely. Beyond the sentence to sentence is a really important thing, which is what is actually going on in the mechanism of this voice, yeah? I think Tar could go to that kind of almost directly. He could kind of get the needle in sharp.
Let's have one more question, if there is one. If not, then I think Lazar would like to close with a very short... Yeah.
Did I stay here?
Yeah.
Is it possible? This is a translation by Ottilie Mulzet. I will leave everything here. The valleys, the hills, the paths, and the jaybirds from the gardens. I would leave here the petcocks and the padres, heaven and earth, spring and fall. I would leave here the exit routes, the evenings in the kitchen, the last amorous gaze, and all of the city-bound directions that make you shudder. I would leave here the thick twilight falling upon the land, gravity, hope, enchantment, and tranquility. I would leave here those beloved and those close to me, everything that touched me, everything that shocked me, fascinated and uplifted me. I would leave here the noble, the benevolent, the pleasant, and the demonically beautiful. I would leave here the budding sprouts, every birth and existence. I would leave here incantation, enigma, distances, inexhaustibility, and the intoxication of eternity. For here, I would leave this earth and these stars, because I would take nothing with me from here, because I've looked into what's coming, and I don't need anything from here.